You're listening to the audio production of How to Be Rich. It's not what you have, it's what you do with what you have, by Andy Stanley, published by Zondervan and read by Stu Gray. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit www.harperchristianaudio.com.
Introduction. Like most young men, I grew up hoping to be R.I.C.H. Not filthy rich, not private jet rich, just rich enough to be able to do what I wanted, when I wanted, without worrying about how much it cost. You know, average rich. My initial strategy for attaining rich was to be a rock star and live in hilltop houses, drive in 15 cars. So I taught myself to play the guitar and piano, rounded up a few high school friends, and started a band. I had no doubt that I was on my way to fortune and fame. Actually, I really didn't care about the fame part. From the beginning, I've been convinced that it is better to be rich than famous. Anonymity was a price I was willing to pay. Now, as you might imagine, my parents weren't thrilled with my career choice, my dad in particular. When people asked me what I was planning to do when I grew up, my dad would give me that look and then answer for me, "Andy hasn't decided yet." Needless to say, the rock star thing didn't work out. If country music had been as big in the 70s as it is now, I might have had a chance. And honestly, sometimes when I play that old six string, I think about you, wonder what went wrong. Yeah, let's move on. Once I accepted the fact that I didn't have the chops for the music biz, I was forced to come up with another get-rich career scheme. And that's when it hit me. The ministry. I'll be a pastor. After all, pastors have lots of money. Now, while that may be true to a limited extent today, back then, I had never heard of a rich preacher. As you probably know, my dad is a pastor. My parents never owned their own home until I was in middle school. Before that, we lived in a parsonage, a house that a church purchased for the pastor and his family to use. It came with the job, was just part of the package. Kind of like being the president of the United States, except we had to mow the lawn. And unlike the first family, we had to get permission to redecorate or repaint or re-anything. After all, it wasn't our house. It was the people's house, as in church people. And church people can be particular about what you do with their house. And that's understandable. In those days, pastors didn't stay more than 3 or 4 years. So there was no point in making a lot of expensive changes for someone who wasn't going to be around that long. All that to say, the notion of getting rich by way of pastoring never dawned on me. As I said, I'd never met a rich preacher. And we certainly weren't rich. Not the kind of rich I was dreaming of, anyway. We always had enough. But rich is about having more than enough. We had what we needed. But rich is about having more than you need. Rich is about having extra, isn't it? When I was in fifth grade, we lived in a small town in Florida where my dad was the pastor of the First Baptist Church. The parsonage was located in a typical small town, middle class neighborhood. Not upper middle class, just middle class. One afternoon, my dad asked me to ride with him when we took our housekeeper home. Yes, we had a housekeeper. Back then, we referred to her as our maid. And she was fine with that. Actually, she was proud of that. She was the preacher's maid, and she made sure all her maid friends knew about it. Normally, she drove, but on this particular afternoon, her car was in the shop. So we drove her home. Turns out, I had never been to that particular part of our small town. The houses were small, the yards were mostly dirt, and there was junk everywhere. I still remember feeling uncomfortable. When we got to her house, she invited us in. I remember thinking, I don't want to go in there. For whatever reason, we didn't. When we got back home, our house looked large by comparison. Our yard looked manicured by comparison. Even our car felt fine in comparison to what I saw in our maid's neighborhood. It was while we were living in that same house that a friend from church came over to play. His name was Bruce. I can still remember Bruce standing in our kitchen, looking around and saying, "Andy, your house is so big. Are you rich?" I was so uncomfortable. Rich? We weren't rich. And our house wasn't big. Our house was normal size. But when we took Bruce home that evening, I understood. By comparison, our house was big. By comparison, I'm sure it looked to Bruce as if we were rich. Heck, by comparison, we were rich. And therein lies the problem, doesn't it? Rich is the other guy. Rich is that other family. Rich isn't just having extra. Rich is having as much extra as the person who has more extra than you do. Rich is having more than you currently have. If that's the case, you can be rich and not know it. You can be rich and not feel it. You can be rich and not act like it. And that is a problem. In fact, that's why I wrote this book. If you purchase this book with your own money, or could have, had you been so inclined, you are much further ahead of the financial game than you might imagine. And if that's hard for you to imagine, no worries. For the next 7 chapters, I'm going to do my best to convince you that you are, in fact, a have rather than a have-not. Better yet, I'm going to use everything in my arsenal of persuasive powers to convince you that you are rich. Once you're convinced, I'm going to walk you through a short passage from the New Testament that instructs us rich people how to be good at it. Because, as you are about to discover, assuming you haven't observed this already, most rich people aren't all that good at being rich. Perhaps you included. While this is a new publication for me, this is not a new message. Every fall for the past 7 years, I've stood in front of our Atlanta area churches and told them they are a bunch of haves who act like have-nots, and that God and I aren't happy about it. Okay, that's not exactly how I phrased it, but when it comes to this particular topic, I've been known to be uncomfortably bold. Our church's journey began with a message series I preached in 2007 entitled How to Be Rich. 2 things prompted the series. First, our culture's incessant messages about how to get rich, when, in fact, most of us got rich a long time ago and nobody told us. Second, Paul's instructions to Timothy regarding how rich Christians are to behave. After studying the passage, I was left with the realization that a lot of rich Christians are not very good at being rich. Then it dawned on me. Well, of course they're not. Nobody has taught them how. So for 4 weekends, I navigated our congregation through the terms and conditions of Paul's instructions to rich people. The series resulted in a lot of healthy conversations. So I followed up the next year with a message on the same topic, combined with a month-long generosity campaign aimed at our local communities. I told our congregants that we were going to practice being rich, so we would be good at it should we ever be so fortunate. The generosity campaign included a hefty donation goal that was due by the end of the week. Most of it came in that day. In addition to financial support for local and international charities, we asked them to donate 2 or 3 hours of their time over the course of the month by volunteering at the charities chosen to receive the funds we collected. And by the way, none of these charities asked us for money. That's what makes a Be Rich campaign so much fun. Behind the scenes, a team of church staff and volunteers went into our local communities to find charities that were making a measurable difference, but who could use a little wind in their sails. So imagine their surprise a few weeks later when a handful of our folks showed up at their doors with checks. In most cases, big checks. Checks they were not expecting. And imagine the reaction a few weeks after that when we opened our services with a video of staff and volunteers at these world-class charities receiving their surprise donations. Not a dry eye in the place. Suddenly and simultaneously, everybody in the house experienced the truth of Jesus' words that it is, in fact, more blessed to give than to receive. In the fall of 2012, I challenged our churches to give $1.5 million toward our Be Rich Giving initiative. They gave $5.2 million in a week, and we in turn gave 100% of it away. No shipping and handling costs, no overhead or operating expenses, no expensive vacations for the pastor and his family. We gave it all away. In addition, our congregants provided 34,000 volunteer hours to local charities that are volunteer dependent. And if that weren't enough, we collected 20,332 Operation Christmas Child shoeboxes for Samaritan's Purse, the largest collection they've ever received from a local church. Pretty good for rich rehearsal. Am I bragging? Heck yeah. I'm so proud of our churches that I get misty-eyed just thinking about the difference they made and continue to make. 2 months ago, my daughter Allie and I visited our international partner in San Salvador, La Casa de Mi Padre, my father's house, a group home for children who can't live with their families for a variety of heartbreaking reasons. Gary Powell, executive director, picked us up at the airport and asked, "How do you like my truck?" Before I could answer, he smiled and said, "It's a Be Rich truck. Thank you." While we were there, we spent time with a local construction crew building a large retaining wall on the edge of their property. As we were leaving, Gary leaned over and said, "That's a Be Rich wall. Tell your folks thanks." While visiting the children's home, Gary introduced me to their newest employee, a licensed marriage and family counselor, a position they desperately needed as they seek to reconnect children with their families. As we left her office, Gary smiled and said, "Thanks to Be Rich. Thank you." Now, I realize you and your church are already doing amazing things in your community and around the world. I assume you have your own stories you could tell. My purpose in writing this book is not to replace or improve anything you are currently doing. My goal is to create a tool that will force conversation and reflection around the topic of what to do with what we have. On this point, Jesus could not have been clearer. It's not what you have that matters. It's what you do with what you have that will count either for you or against you in the kingdom of heaven. Just so we're clear, I'm not a philanthropist. While I care about the poor, the issue of local or global poverty doesn't keep me up at night. I'm concerned for the plight of children, but I'm not on a mission to get all the available orphans in the world adopted into Christian homes. Though, like you, I sure wish they could be. My passion, and a major reason I want to get this message into your hands, is my concern for the reputation and cultural positioning of the local church. I want you to help me re-anchor the church to undeniable, mind-boggling, culture-shifting demonstrations of compassion and generosity. Because, as we will discuss in Chapter 7, generosity was the hallmark of the early church. They did for those who could not do or would not do anything in return. Because, as we will discuss in Chapter 7, generosity was the hallmark of the early church. They did for those who could not do or would not do anything in return. That was new. That got people's attention. Eventually, it shifted and shaped the moral conscience of the West. But for that to happen, there must be several shifts in our thinking. And one of those shifts relates to how we define rich. So, here we go. Chapter 1. Celebration is in order. You can never be too rich or too thin. Wallace Simpson, Duchess of Windsor. By the time they brought the patient to him, the situation looked grave. Miss A, as she was called in medical journals, was visibly stricken, and her motor skills had been reduced to semi-controlled trembles, the telltale movements of someone nearing the end. In the confusing mix of symptoms, her family suspected tuberculosis or a blood disease. She looked less like a treatable patient and more like a discarded cadaver from behind the town hospice. Her cheeks were sunken and her skin was like cheesecloth draped over a fossil. The notion that this doctor could save her was a long shot. The possibility that she would make a complete recovery was inconceivable. Miss A's pulse was an exceptionally low 46, and her respiration was weak. But there was a nervous energy about her that suggested very high hormone levels. It didn't make sense. Her organ function, urine, and appetite were all normal. And yet, she was clearly dying. In 1866, modern medicine wasn't even a dream yet. There were no CAT scans or MRIs or tests to determine blood counts or endocrine levels. The practice of medicine was little more than a catalog of barbaric experiments. Common techniques included bloodletting, opium injections, electric shock, and turpentine enemas. These grotesque procedures were often the final nail in the coffin for someone already weakened by fever or infection. Diseases were the leading cause of death, followed closely by the trial methods devised to treat them.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.